Who is Christ? What is God? Who is God? What is prayer? Why do we even pray? When we pray, are we talking to ourselves? And if we're talking to ourselves, are we creating narcissists? And if these narcissists grow up, what kind of society are they going to be living in? Who are they going to be communicating? What's their psychic energy going to be creating? These are very interesting questions. So in his commentary on 1 Corinthians 15:24, in Elude, Tunct et Ipse Filius, and elsewhere, these are very smart philosophers I'm talking about here, okay? Nicen deepened Origen's thought in this respect, as in many others, and claimed that God will indeed be all in all, according to the capacity of each recipient and in a precise order, depending on the degree of each one's adhesion to the good. So God is good in this instance. And if the more good you do, the closer you are to good, the closer, the faster you will be get to God, who is all in all. The further away from God you are by doing sin and whatnot, you'll be further from God and you'll be the least one to be all in all. Okay, that's what they're saying here. Well, in 1 Corinthians 15:24, then cometh the end when he, Jesus Christ, shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. So in the golden age of philosophy, you had Socrates, who said, know thyself. He was the original narcissist, you could say. Then you had Plato, who basically created the society we live in today, plutocratic socialism, which means that the smart rule the world. And then you have the Aristotle, who said that God is the unmoved mover and that everything collects into himself. Well, these are truths that have been passed down from God for a very long time, rehashed over and over. Divinity, or the higher principle, far from being in all, is itself in nothing, but is the order of other things that participate in it. All those that which can be present to it, and insofar as they can be present to it. This is a criticism of the tenet that God is all in all. Although Origen himself is keen on explaining that Christ, God, and the world of ideas, including virtues, does not participate in everything, but is participated by the people that share the given virtue. So Christ is justice. Because Christ is justice, he's something that we look to as a hero. And people then can morph that into whatever it is that they want if they do not know the Bible. So in Romans 3:25, God has set forth to be appropriation through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. You know, you can get an NIV, you can get a different version, you can look that up. Essentially what that means is that we deserve wrath. The world deserves wrath. The people deserve wrath. But God, through his mercy and putting off the debt that was owed, putting it off for a very long time, he had to satisfy it at some point. And he did it through Jesus Christ, and he satisfied it once and for all. And so therefore, Christ is justice. That's how they look at him when they look at him in such a way with a worldly lens, okay? And philosophy, navel gazing and breaking up God and talking about things over and over and over and over and over again. It gets muddy. And so you have Jesus Christ, looks like Che Guevara, a communist. And so see, he could be morphed into whatever. And then, you know, just like a Marvel comic superhero. Just change suits. So an animal groupthink, like what we just read about, that people participate in an idea and they run with it. Look at these fish. They're beautiful, right? They stick together. Did you know that, let me rewind this here. Did you know that school of fish can get together in big groups like this and they can confuse predators? They can scare predators. They also do maneuvers to stay away from predators like this. So in the world and the theory of evolution and survival of the fittest, a shark, you know, if you want to survive, you better grow the capacity to stay away from the shark, and then therefore you can survive and breed and continue. Well, the way Christians look at it, the way Jesus Christ is teaching us, is that the devil's out roaring like this shark, roaring about like a lion, looking to devour the sheep. And this collective thought as a Christian, it's a very good group to stay in, okay, according to these guys, if you want to stick to that language with animal group think behavior stuff. But what do these guys think? Okay, here's the definition of animal group behavior. Group behavior is what animals do with other animals to help them survive. Groups can be large, like a herd of million wild beasts, or small, like a pride of few lions. Humans live in groups also, and we work together to help one another. The purpose of group behavior is to help living things survive. Jesus Christ taught us to die to ourselves in this world, to give up lust and the sins of this world. Animal group behavior can involve a few animals or thousands. Doesn't seem like it's so popular, right? Doesn't seem like it'd fit in this. Animal group behavior can involve a few animals or thousands. There can be over 1 million wild beasts in Africa. I'm not saying that right, but these animals, okay? A million of them working together. When a predator gets near, they make an alarm call, basically telling each other, "Hey, get out of the way." They stay close to zebras, and they actually hang out with zebras, okay? They travel 500 miles. They migrate. We talked about this in previous videos when comparing humans to animals, Bible studies. Groups can help animals defend themselves, okay? Groups can help animals gather food. Look at these beautiful symbiotic relationships. It all is the same thing over and over and over and over until you get to humans, which are the ultimate creation, the ultimate. Here we go. Animal research, groupthink in both camps. This was a very interesting article that came across. Professors like me, with established research credentials at animal research intensive universities, who are also members of People for Ethical Treatment of Animals, are rare. So this guy is just, he's a niche, right? He's very niche. But a dual identity as a research faculty member and an animal advocate affords a unique perspective on both camps. A striking similarity between the two is that animal researchers and defenders of animals both employ groupthink, a mode of thought that people engage in when they are deeply involved in a cohesive in-group, where members striving for unanimity override their motivation to realistically appraise alternative courses of action. So when it comes to survival of the fittest, Christianity is not the best group to get into. You know what I mean? If we're looking at it in high school and we're looking at it in groups, you're looking at the shark and their buddies. They're probably like the preps, right? The school of fish are just like the regular general population. Then you got the goths and those people, and then you got the Christians, and they would be the weakest. But see, that's the great thing, is that God says that when you get wisdom in Him and you get knowledge in Him, you may look weak, but you are stronger than a shark. These guys want to dissect this all day long and come up with just stuff, this stuff. Princeton University, get moving, the mystery of animal group behavior. This phenomenon, they can't even explain it, is behavioral cascade. This has long confounded biologists. How decisions about which way to move and how fast are communicated to many individuals, often numbering in the hundreds or even thousands. And how are these decisions processed and coordinated so swiftly? This is a little understood topic. And then if you watch this video, Evolution Theory, Neurons and Metaphysics, we talk about this, and it breaks it down to the brain and neurons traveling down your body, giving you impulses and you can create memories and different synapses. And the brain is beautiful, neuroplasticity, which we're going to get into. And so these fish, it's like a circuitry board, like a computer. They're able to maneuver the same way. This behavior is analogous to an avalanche or a wave. It begins by a fast and sudden burst of swimming initiated by one or more fish responding to a perceived threat. Think about a soccer game where everyone is doing the wave. I stand up, then you stand up, and then the next person stands up. You can think of this as behavioral cascade, so that the behavior standing up is cascading through a group like a wave. However, a large cascade, one that spreads through the whole school, depends on how close the fish are together. It's kind of like if you're across a movie theater from me and you yell and you startle me. I might not startle right away, but if you're right next to me, I will. This is Joseph, a graduate student in ecology and evolutionary biology. So essentially, if you're yelling, if somebody hears gunshots, like we're going to see here, their survival instinct is to run away. Maybe to laugh like these guys. Maybe to just kind of enjoy being shot at. People are being told that death is okay, that death is a good thing, and life is worthless, and that you're an animal. I saw this. I'm not a fan of South Park necessarily. Down with the monarchy, anarchy. Shoot them up. These people, rich people, have been studying. I'm going to get to manipulation. They study and they think of people as animals. And they study God's creation. And instead of attributing it to God, they attribute it to themselves. And they attribute it to paganism and all this junk. And then guess what? They create it evil. Begets evil. God laid it out in the Bible. If he doesn't get worshipped, you're going to get this. So we have protesting. And then we have art. Look, it looks, get it in good trouble. Get in good trouble. Okay? Rise up. Looks so cute. Art should disturb the comfortable and comfort the disturbed. You know? Make blood and hate cutesy? I don't know. I want to play this. These are people at a protest. Black Lives Matter. And they're sitting on a car. The cop can't see this man right here. You see him? Maybe the cop can't see him necessarily. Getting things thrown at him. Doesn't matter. He falls off. Boom. He's probably dead. I don't know. That he's probably dead. Okay? And then now guess what? People get even more violent. Now we have a right to do violence to you. Now we have a right to do violence to you because you did violence to me. Who started this all? Why is this happening? Why are you watching this video? Are you even paying attention? What's in these videos? Is there truth to what I'm saying? World War III, MAGA Trumpers shot and killed. A warning to us all, how the honeypot works. How the rich man laugh all the way to the bank. Okay? These people know how to break people up into groups, have them hate each other, and now with technology, they're able to broadcast it everywhere and make mockery of everything. This side does this, this side does that. How about the people at the top are destroying people's souls?
Separation from the antagonizers and the protesters, and you are being watched. You are racist. They are giving a speech about black lives, but yet you want to destroy on behalf of black lives, and that one person over there is black.
What's going on? This is what John F. Kennedy said, okay? Our president, 35th president. Those who make peaceful revolution impossible will make violent revolution inevitable by breaking up people, destroying their soul. This is what it comes down to, destroying their soul. You're going to make violent revolution inevitable. By destroying the soul, you're going to make violent revolution inevitable. That's going to happen. Why? Because of all the injustices. In a free society, art is not a weapon. Wow. Artists are not engineers of the soul. This is how worship music, art, movies, Hollywood, the Illuminati taking over arts and education. That happened. The Bavarian Illuminati said exactly what they're going to do. The pagans have taken over. The Freemasons have taken over, right? And they want a new age religion. They want to get rid of God and they want a new age religion. They want people to clash so badly and bring in order. The rights of man come not from the generosity of the state, but the hand of God. So even these guys, carpetbaggers, people that are immoral, but are prideful, that want to get in positions of power, they even recognize the relationship between propaganda and information cascades. Propaganda, what is it? It's basically a false date on dispatch, unverified rumors expressed as truths and insinuations that often have little basis. Moreover, propaganda tends to avoid abstract ideas and appeal to emotions. That's why we're breaking this down. And if you when you look at it and you evaluate what these men and women are saying, it's wrong and it's evil. They don't, and the more that you try to take these abstract ideas, grant these big ideas, these awesome concepts, these God, that God has made, metaphysics, all this stuff, when they try to break it down more and more and they don't give glory to God, you get propaganda. Information cascade, because people, their behavior is based on information. So information cascade is a phenomenon in which an individual ignores his or her own signal in the face of signals from other individuals. Basically, people that want to have control over their own environment. We talk about this in the last video, narcissism and psychic energy. They can't get over the fact that people aren't like schools of fish, where they people have their own free will. Information cascade is a phenomenon in which an individual ignores his or own signal in the face of signals from other individuals. Studies have shown that this effect can be quite powerful. Research conducts show that people sometimes follow the crowd in a decision, such as which object is larger, even if the crowd's answer is obviously wrong. In one study, researchers found that if one person stared at the sky, very few others did. If there was a group of five, then more people stared at the sky. Once a group contained 15 people, approximately 45% of the people looked up in the sky. So if people see something in the sky, don't you think other people are going to take notice and want to look in the sky? But see, small nothing brains like a fish, then, and they're self-replicating food sources. They look at that and they impose that on human beings. And although it's done by this, it's the same design by the creator, they go, oh, we're going to now use this as an excuse to manipulate mankind. And I'm going to get right into that. And you think I'm lying? We're going to look at that. Edward Bernays, the world's most incredible spin master. Sigmund Freud's nephew. Sigmund Freud is a very disgusting man. And we talk about that in the last video, narcissism, empathy. His nephew fought discrimination against women by their husbands in 1929. He organized an Easter Sunday protest to force husbands to allow women to smoke. His protest went viral overnight, and soon women could smoke just about any dang place that they wanted. Okay. It was revolutionary. He created a form of media and entertainment and mixing information and information cascades to manipulate behavioral cascades, aka there's enough people looking up in the sky because we have enough newspapers going out everywhere and everybody's going to read the same ad. We have enough people looking up in the sky, so we're going to get even more people looking up in the sky. Wow! Smart, brilliant! That's what's going on here. Okay. And these are very sick people with sick minds that want to put in sick things into this type of propaganda. Life magazine named him one of the 100 most influential Americans of the 20th century. His biography by Larry Tai is called The Father of Spin, and it's not because of his expertise with laundry. The BBC made a documentary about him called The Century of the Self, The Century of the Narcissist. Bernays' double uncle was Sigmund Freud. Freud was his double uncle? Yes. Bernays' mother was Freud's sister, and his father was the brother of Freud's wife. A lot of inside, like a lot of people just wanting to have relations within close camps. Yeah, Sigmund Freud was famous for that. So here's Life magazine and America, the domesticity of evil, Hitler's home and America's magazines before and after the war. In late 1930s, the Nazis gave Adolf Hitler a PR makeover. They got enough people to look up in the sky, got enough people to look at the magazines. Features were published in countless magazines, both German and American, that outlined his home decor, daily activities, and his favorite foods. Yummy. In a letter on June 5th, 1940, Edward Bernays wrote to Henry Luce, owner of Life magazine, advising him against publishing a puff piece on Adolf Hitler. Bernays warned, "America is prone to hero worship." Guess what's happening now? People aren't worshiping the Marvel and stuff. You're going to have that porch, but people are going back to Christ. Totally opposite of what these guys are trying to push. Don't let them treat you like animals. Bernays warned, "America is prone to hero worship, and if Hitler should be successful in his plans for war and genocide," see, they knew what this guy was doing. They knew exactly what he was doing. "That America may find admiration in his success and may well turn a present hate into admiration," meaning we don't want people to find out what's going on in the society and who's manipulating who and what's doing what. And so you had Life magazine and all these guys put out a lot of publications hailing Nazi Germany and Hitler. And what Hitler was going after was obviously very evil, destroying, but what he was using as truth, because the people knew, just like they know now, that the financial institutions are robbing you. That, I mean, we could go on and on. Okay? And so these politicians, these evil men, use the truth and then they sneak in and they do evil. Kind of like what I'm explaining to you right now. Strategies of persuasion, manipulation, and propaganda, psychological and social aspects. So this is just one paper that I saw. They create these types of studies and they read them and then they create media and different brands and companies so they can figure out how to manipulate you. How one can influence the behavior of others? What is a good persuasion strategy? It is obviously of great importance to determine what information best to provide and also how to convey it. To delineate how and when manipulation of others can be successful, the first part of this paper reviews basic findings of decision and game theory on models of strategic communication. You know what they say about Donald Trump? That he's awesome at game theory. They love saying that he's awesome at game theory. I just want to point that out. I don't know if that means anything to anybody or what, but here we go. Many important features of strategic, just pay attention to how many times the word manipulation is used here, right? Many important features of strategic manipulation have not been addressed and must be left for future work. We have not at all addressed the case where several manipulators with different motives compete for influence over the population opinion. In that case, we would really consider a full game problem where what is a good manipulation strategy also depends on what competing manipulators do. So the world has to be a stage in order for this study to really hammer in. You get it? On how to control population. We have also assumed that the pragmatic one-to-one aspect of opinion manipulation does not play a role when it comes to social problem, blah, 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 blah. And it goes on, I think it says manipulation 4 or 5 more times. This is from the CIA. It's declassified or it's approved. I'm not sure. It was on their website. I want to point this out right here. Public relations is born as disinformation. During two subsequent decades of peace in which the trauma of an economic collapse followed the delirium of a perilous prosperity, a subtle yet significant development shaped the future of information, the rise of public relations and its professional advocates. Exemplified by Edward Bernays, a man who began his career as a consultant to the U.S. delegation to the Versailles Peace Conference, which terminated World War I. wow, how did he get there? And what, how did, how the heck did he get there? Right? You'd think that. And then it ended, he ended as a hired hand for the United Fruit Company in Latin America. Public relations and its covert marketing strategies quickly seeped into the very core of American life. As Bernays cynically stated in a PR manual in 1928, the conscience and intelligent manipulation of the organized habits and opinions of the masses is an important element in democratic society. Those who manipulate this unseen mechanism of society constitute an invisible government in which is the true ruling power of our country. It is the intelligent minorities which need to make use of propaganda continuously and systematically. This is what the man who created propaganda says. So basically, it's plutocratic socialism rehashed. This is what the whole entire theory of evolution video series comparing humans and animals is about. They're rehashing and they're saying, okay, propaganda is basically lies to manipulate people. That's it. That's it. That's all it is. It's lies to manipulate people. And if we get enough newspapers and television and we get enough mockingbird media and we get enough people that, like Zelensky in Ukraine, TV actors, to get into positions of power, we can then decimate societies. We can do whatever we want because guess what? Now we are the rulers of the unseen hand. That's why it's important to trust Jesus Christ and lean on him. Do this now, my son, and deliver thyself. When thou art come into the hand of thy friend, go humble thyself and make sure thy friend. Give not sleep to the eyes, nor slumber to the eyelids. Deliver yourself as a roe from the hand of a hunter. Deliver yourself, right now I'm telling you, deliver yourself as a roe from the hand of the hunter and as a bird from the hand of the fowler. Go to the ant, thou sluggard, myself included. Consider her ways and be wise. Look at God. Look at Jesus Christ. Look at his amazing creation and get wise. Which having no guide, overseer, or ruler, provideth her meat in the summer and gathereth her food in the harvest. Why are these mechanical little robot ants able to do all these things? Why is it that they're able to lay scent down when they're creating a trail and then they all follow behind that? Why do they even evolve to do that? They can't even figure out what divides cells. They can't even agree on the three brains that morph together to create the human brain. They can't even, that's a lie. Anyway. They want to take away God and they want to give this as entertainment. They want to give Star Trek and say that people can become like Star Trek through evolution, right? That's what they're doing. I have family members that act like Kirk through their thoughts and the way they talk. You know, people... It's mockingbird media. So they want to go and travel the universe and then give propaganda like this and say that Jesus Christ, who is a justice type character, is no different than, here we go, you ready?
You've been there?
Once I stretched out my hand and earth trembled and I breathed upon it and spring returned.
You mentioned Agamemnon, Hector, Odysseus. How do you know about them?
Search your most distant memories, those of the thousands of years past, and I am there. Your fathers knew me, and your fathers' fathers.
Isn't it funny how they'll say God, Christ, isn't real, but then they love to use the Bible and God's wisdom and everything to create their own stories, to create their own theologies, to create their own philosophies. Isn't that funny? It's like the Bible is the standard that everybody uses. So let me break it down this way. If we're talking about narcissism and people looking inward, it would be like people looking at the Bible and taking it up, knowing it's the truth and the standard, and just regurgitating things that have nothing to do with the Bible, and then people follow that. Genesis 6:2. Oh, this is what I wanted to say. Here we go.
The travelers.
So in this, he starts to lust after the woman, the human woman. Okay. And the science, the theory of evolution, what they'll do is they'll go, okay, the Bible is just a fictional story, but there are some truths to fiction. And so they'll take out this concept and they'll blow it up into like this science fiction story, like Star Trek, which you're going to hear. Okay. This is how, and then they'll be able to go, that little piece right there in the Bible, this is what Satan does. That little piece right there, here, look it over here. There's a little bit of poison in the gum, in the yummy goodness, right? Okay. That's what they do. And then you got The Rock and you got all these actors that once they get to a certain age, they become effeminized and weird. And then they try to drag you down with them.
Do you mind telling us what you want without all the Olympian generalities?
So he lusts after her, Genesis 6:2, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and that they took them wives, all that they chose. And they'll say that it's aliens or it's false people and false, you know, false gods on lands far away. And then this is other entertainment.
Unscheduled off-world activation.
Stargate portals. And so, again, here we go. They'll say that the devil doesn't exist, but they love to use him.
Some kind of
ball. Stand out, boys.
Wow, buddy. We were just talking about you. All good.
By now, you are aware of the Replicator threat in the galaxy, and that my fleet has engaged them in battle.
There's been a little chit and chat.
So basically, this guy is talking with the devil, like no big deal. Coast to Coast AM, Alex Jones, what I was just talking about. They like to take the Bible and create New Age stuff. It's confusion. They just love confusing people. They love splitting people up into different, you know, fragments. Okay, here we go. And then the mind. This is how beautiful the mind is. You see these people, these women. These are telephone operators back in the 1930s, 40s. And your brain works just like this. It's called neuroplasticity. What is neuroplasticity? Brain plasticity. It's the ability to adapt and change. Experiences or memories change a brain's physical structure. A brain's function can then move. This is how amazing the brain is. A brain's function can move from a damaged area to an undamaged area, and it can rewire and rework itself and build itself. It's like a muscle, and it can grow and it can get stronger. Isn't it funny how these guys, they want to then now pervert people's minds and want to destroy their souls? Acts 17:27, that they should seek the Lord if haply they might feel after him, meaning find him. Find him deeply, feel him, though that he may not be far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we also are his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead, meaning God, his nature, who he is like unto gold or silver or stone or graven by art or man's devices. And the times of this ignorance, everything we talked about, all the philosophers, everything talked, God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. Everything up to Jesus Christ, God allowed people to talk about the philosophy, everything up until Jesus Christ, he allowed. Everything afterwards is children's imagination. All philosophies, all theologies, everything wrapped up in Christ, God's word, design, creation, everything, the Alpha and the Omega, the King. Everything after Christ, child's play. And he's saying, hey, God's winked at you. Now, here's the truth. Repent. I want to end it on this. I didn't follow Christ for a very long time in my life, it seems. But in eternity, it doesn't mean anything. Especially when I get to look at my kids and I just want peace for them. So we're like grass, we wither away, but the times I've wasted, it all goes away like a flame when you decide to give yourself to Christ. I met a man in church, 55 years old, said that he could not believe he wasted his time all these years. Okay, burn real fast. You give yourself to him.
Loved me with a perfect love, but still I wander, still I roam. God help me, burn field, till I'm really, truly, wholly yours.
And how do you do that? You don't do that by filling your mind in with this junk and this animalistic junk that these people are trying to, these rich men that don't care about you and your family. God has given you the way out. God's word, fill your mind in with music, beautiful music like this music. I don't know about the people, right? We don't know about the people, but fill your music with good things from the Lord. Understand the evil, understand all that stuff, but focus on him. And like this music I'm gonna play here, it's beautiful. Life becomes a symphony. Blessed are those who read and hear, and they know the time is near. Wake up. Wake up. What are you wasting your life on? Stop it. Get to work. Do great things for the Lord. Find a church, find good people around you that love the Lord, and find good people and get to work. You'll start to burn up for them. You're going to find evil people. You're going to find evil people, and it's going to hurt you. But you just keep burning for him, and you'll be untouchable. Seven seas and seven thunders. Seven angels, seven trumpets. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. John 8:32, ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And the truth is the Lord Jesus Christ, not Buddha, not any of these people. They're people that God winked at. The truth is Jesus Christ.